Thank you so much for doing this interview, first of all. We really appreciate it. I started in 2017, so I was there for one of your convos, not when the shoe drive actually happened, but it's really cool. I remember that story. It's an insane story, and so cool what you've been able to do for the kingdom through that. So I know that's not where it started, though. So, like, where did it start? Tell me about your childhood and your time as a refugee and how that kind of enabled you to be able to do that.
So originally I was born in the Republic of the Congo. Congo is such a beautiful country with mountains and rivers and wild animals and all these things and the natural resources in our country, but we've never experienced peace, and that's been the biggest problem in my country. We are so wealthy in terms of natural minerals, but we are considered the poorest country, which you can never understand.
Yeah.
That means people come and take what is now country, but they have no respect for human life. So I grew up in that environment with my family, and that's the biggest one that we experienced. That we, after that, we had to leave and became refugees again. Just hearing the bombs and the gunshots that had to continue the whole night, you know, and knowing that the rebels have taken over the city and they're coming down on your side, you know, how do you feel as a young child?
Mm-hmm.
And back and looking at my sisters and my siblings, where everybody is frightening and they're afraid and they're crying, and looking at my parents, where we just don't know what to do. You know, that's when, because my dad was a preacher, and that's when he would gather the family and say, you know what, we're not going to allow fear consume our lives, so let's just pray and invite God, knowing that God is able to protect all of us, you know. They are burning the city. What do you do? You know, we went through the whole night in fear. But after a short period of time, then the following day, we stayed again because we could not leave with everybody because we had a big family. So we had to stay for one more day while all the neighborhood, everybody's sleeping, you know. And then eventually my dad decided to go. Said that we got to leave the city and move to the village, which we can get in a, we can get on a bus, we can drive or anything, but we have to walk. And the message was, keep moving forward, but not look behind, you know. You know, walking miles, sleep in the jungle, believing that God is going to get us through, you know, knowing that you could get attacked by an animal, by rebels. But we walked in a mass, a group of people, just the same way the Israelites walked out of Egypt going to Canaan. Our life became normal to us, that we'll go to a place, stay for a certain period of time, then move. And then it got to a point where things got worse, and there was so much abuse, and I was even afraid of my mom and my sisters, that we and all of us, that we can't stay in this country no more. So we had to leave by the help of a good Samaritan, and we moved to Kenya, and then we became refugees there for 9 years. That's just to make my story short.
Yes.
And we became refugees there for 9 years. We thought, like, okay, now we're safe. But that was another different life, you know, where we move into another country where we don't know anyone. We can, it's so hard for us to get a job. It's so hard for us to provide for ourselves.
And I remember hearing you say in convo a few years ago about how when you were in those moments where you weren't sure if you guys were going to come out on the other end alive, you would say, like, God, if you deliver me from this, like, I will make my life about devoted to you.
I remember I prayed those prayers so many times that I got to a place where I was like, God, if you save me from all this, if you do this with me, this and this, and protect my family and get me out of this situation, I will serve you for the rest of my life, you know. So I got to a point where I was like, God has to come save us. And if he does not come, then we're done. Because you look around and you see there is no help. It says, the Bible says, I look up to the mountain, where does my help come? My help comes from the Lord, the makers of heaven and the earth. So I looked around and observed the situation, my family, the situation we are in. And I was like, there is no one that is able to save us if it's not God, you know? So those promises that I made, praying, and I'm telling God, if you do this for me and my family, I give you my life.
Yes.
Take use me the way you want. You know, but I was setting myself up not knowing that that time will come. You know, so God did it, saved my family.
Yes.
Now we are in America.
Yes.
Now those things were coming now. So what are you going to do for God now? God saved your family, you know. So I kind of remember the promises that I made to God and everything that I told him that if you do this for me, then I will do this for you. So what I'm doing now is actually paying back all the promises and all the things that I said back then. So what I'm doing now is just like, God, I remember what you did for me and I promise that I will serve you.
Yes.
Now I have an opportunity. So I'm actually really paying back and saying the things that I promised him that I would do for him.
And when did that become shoes for you?
When I was a refugee, that I lacked a pair of shoes. And I was in a prayer, and I was the only young child, and everybody's were parents. I was the only one, because my mom would always take me to prayers. And then I raised a concern or a need, and I said, I need a pair of shoes, because I didn't have one that time. And they asked anybody was in need. I raised my hand and they told me, go on your knees, and they prayed for me. And it was for a pair of shoes. And I felt like the time I went on my knees, it was written that I'll be given thousands of shoes. I think it was written that I will never lack, that God will use me. Because if someone would have come to me that time and tell me that you'll be the one giving shoes, I would have been like, nah, where would that, how would this happen? I don't have one. How will I be the one providing shoes while I don't have one?
Yeah.
Coming back here in the US, then I looked at how much we have and I started collecting the shoes in my own house and boxing them and stop wasting anymore. And that's when the movement started. In 2015, I went to the Congo. And then when I already have a box, some boxes in my house collected, and I looked around and seeing children are suffering. No pair of shoes they cannot afford. They got the infections. A lot of them are just barefoot, walking in the street. And I was like, no way. We have so much. I'm now in a country that has plenty, you know. And I looked that, and then I came back, and that became like became a drive. And I told everyone, I think we can, if we can start collecting shoes and the ones we have, we can make an impact in Congo. So that's how we started collecting thousands and thousands until we filled our own house.
Wow.
It was full.
Wow.
Yeah.
Yeah. And then how many were you able to collect when the whole thing with Steph Curry happened?
We collected more than 20,000.
Wow.
At that convocation, because I brought 10. And Liberty collected, and Liberty and everybody since Steph never collected more than 10,000.
And so now you have a book out, the Congo Soul, it's called, correct?
Yeah.
And so when did that come out?
The book was released on October the 13th.
Okay, yeah. Wow. Well, congratulations.
Yeah, thank you.
That's really exciting.
I'm excited. I've been waiting for this to have my story written. And it's finally happened, and I'm so excited that somebody can take my story home and read and get encouraged. It's a story of hope. It's a story, as always say, I'm a voice to the voiceless, and for people that are truly interested with global issues, human rights, people that love to hear good miracles, testimonies, and it touches every angle. That's Congo Soul is all about that. So it's more of like, you want to be encouraged, you want to be lifted spiritually, the right book to get.
That's awesome. And so what's next for you moving forward?
What's next for me moving forward? So in 2019, in collaboration with Samaritan Pass, we shipped more than 50,000 sneakers.
Wow. Do you ever, just to follow up, do you ever hear from anyone that you give the shoes to? Or do you ever get to see that kind of on the other end?
Yeah, I always go on the field. I can never miss that.
Yeah.
2017, I was there. 2015, I was there for about 2 months, and I was in the field, and seeing the joy of the kids, you know, for the first time ever, putting on a pair of shoes, it was the best feeling ever.
Wow.
Now being there in these villages, and I'm providing new Nike sneakers for these kids, and they put on for the first time, walking majestically, feeling like they're on top of the water, you know?
Yeah.
Like they're full of themselves and they're excited. That was the greatest joy of my life, you know? Knowing that I can able to put a smile on these kids, now they can be able to go to school. Now they have no fear of walking on contaminated soil. The best feeling ever in my life.
Yeah.
And people think about the gospel is just about opening the scripture, and that's not. Sometimes being there for these people, you know, providing for these people, you're acting like Christ, mm-hmm. you know, because if you look at Christ, he fed people, he healed the sick. And all these things, and that's who we are. Because me, just providing for these people, providing a pair of shoes, a lot of people came to Christ by just a simple act like mm-hmm. that. Because you're asking, who do you believe in? We want to worship the same God that you believe in, because what you're doing is amazing.
Yeah.
Shoes has been just a platform for me.
Mm-hmm.
People that are looking to serve in our ministry, they're welcome, especially Liberty.
Yeah.
Students who are looking for internship or looking for to travel overseas and make a difference and all these things. People want to fundraise for us and help us in when we have these shoe drives and all these things. They are welcome to do so. You know, the good thing about Liberty is I'm so happy that I'm a product of the school. I'm mm-hmm. really excited that I went to Liberty. And you can see that we are making a difference around the world. And I'm encouraging mm-hmm. other students as well, knowing that you have visions and plans that you want to do. And mine became a success because I never gave up. I trusted mm-hmm. in the Lord. You know, it's the same thing that I'm going to tell my other students who are still in school and those who have graduated, that if he brings the vision, he'll bring the provision, you know, knowing that if you have a vision from God, he will provide and bring people along with you to support and make that reality. That's what has happened to me. And I will tell them, don't give up. And I say, look at my life. And always used me as a perfect example where I had nothing. I was no one. But because I trusted in the Lord and I never gave up and had so much faith in God.
Mm-hmm.
And it's the same thing, that's the success. That's how you become success, when you just don't give up.
Yeah.
Say it. Like, even if you don't see, speak into existence. Like, hey, I know God is going to be able to do it. So it's a blessing that I'm a champion for Christ and I'm going out there. Mm-hmm. I'm sharing my message that Liberty is a great school. They can train people like us that are changing lives outside, and more people coming, you know. So that's the message, and that's who I am.
Yeah. Well, thank you so much. And thanks so much again for just meeting and giving your time.
Yeah, thank you for having me, and I appreciate it. I can't wait to see the article.